and God can break by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ in the cross. Hallelujah. We're glad you're here tonight. Hope you're glad you're here. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a shout. Yeah. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good to see everyone here. We're going to receive our tithe and offering. And Brother Joseph, come. Hallelujah. We're here because people give for us to be here. Hallelujah. Many know the Lord says it's better to give than receive. Hallelujah. Let's give. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you tonight. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your blessings. Lord, we thank you that we have opportunity to give. And Lord, we pray that as people give, Lord, multiply it for your ministry work. Bless each one that gives, Lord God, so they can continue to sow into the kingdom work. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. Over here, Joe. Hallelujah. Well, we're blessed tonight. I've got my nephew, Brother Joseph's going to be preaching. And let me tell you, I don't know if you ever had an opportunity to get up and preach to somebody. It's not as easy as it looks. And Brother Joseph's been, I gave him the date to preach in Brownsville this year coming up. I got to give him more. And that's my job, to develop preachers. And we got one on our hands right now. So we're gonna make sure that he gets all his spaces. I got preachers on the North Shore and the Covington area. I got to give them spots to preach. They got that final place to preach so God can do the work. So praise the Lord. Let's welcome Brother Joseph as he comes.
God for a word, because I believe that when people come to church, they should hear a word from God, not from a man. All the pastors at World Prayer Tabernacle, they're all seeking God for a word. Anytime you come, you're going to hear something from God. You may not like it, but it's from God. So I started seeking God, and just got into prayer. And I was at work, and the news was on. So I wasn't able to watch it. I was listening. They were talking about that San Bernardino shooting in California. And God highlighted a word to me. I asked God for a word. And sometimes when you ask God to give you a message, he just gives you one word, and you got to just go with it. And God highlighted a word to me. This is what it said on the news. They said, "We think the two people that were involved in the shooting had been radicalized." When they said that word, that was it. God said, "That's the word. Radicalized." You see, the news considers these people to be radicals. It's not really true. Truth is, they're really just Muslims. The ones who we consider radical, that's just real Muslims. They're doing what they're supposed to be doing. They're doing what their book tells them to do. And they're doing what their false God tells them to do.
Amen.
See, the ones who sit in the mosque quiet and don't say anything, that's not really Muslims. It's the ones who are acting out on what they believe. You see, there's two types of Muslims. There's the ones we consider to be peaceful, and the ones we consider to be radical. So God began to ask me this. Where are all the radical Christians at?
Come on.
Where are all the radical Christians at? The ones who are not just going to sit in here, but the ones who are going to act out on what I tell them. The ones who are going to do what I tell them to do. And it began to break my heart when he said that. You see, just like we see the Muslims, the two groups, we see the peaceful ones and we see the radical ones. You see, Satan sees the same thing in us. You see, Satan sees the peaceful Christians, the ones he don't worry about. You see, when a peaceful Christian comes into church and he knows they're just coming and just going to hear a message and leave the same way they came in, he don't really care about that person. They're not effective. They're not doing anything to mess up his kingdom, his plans. It's the radical ones he's worried about. It's the ones that he knows, hey, when this person walks into the room, things just might change. He gets scared when a radical Christian walks into the room because he knows that that person just might say something, just might open their mouth, just might mention Jesus, and chains might just begin to fall.
Come on.
Preach, Paul.
You know, I was in Chicago, and I was with Brother EJ, and we were in the room, and the news had came on about the 200 people that just got killed in Paris. And EJ came in the room, and he said, turn our news on, man, you got to see what's going on. And it broke my heart. See, because some radical Muslims decided to show up, 200 people died. But what if instead of that, we heard on the news that 200 radical Christians showed up? That radical Christians showed up and 200 people got saved. What if we heard that? What an impact that would be on the world. The whole world is seeing these Muslims because they're acting on what they believe. The world should be seeing Christians acting on what they believe. People getting saved. Lives getting changed. God's looking for his people to rise up. He's looking for his people to stand up. He's not looking for an audience. He's looking for an army.
Amen.
You see, these Muslims, they serve a false god who calls them slaves. And they know it. There's nothing hidden about that. It's right in their book. They'll never be more than slaves. He tells them that you can have eternal life if your good outweighs your bad. See, they never really know if their good outweighs their bad until they get there. So they're really not sure about eternal life. But the only way they're guaranteed eternal life is if they die while killing in the name of Allah. It's the only way. You see, we serve a God who calls us sons and daughters. Mm-hmm. Who we can refer to as Abba, which means daddy. Mm-hmm. We serve a God who promised us eternal life because he died for us.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
We don't have to die for him. He died for us. All we have to do is accept that. You see, Muslims are strapping bombs to themselves. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine putting a bomb on your body and knowing you're going to die for somebody who calls you a slave? You know, everybody makes a New Year's resolution. The word resolution means to make a firm decision to do and not to do something. I say 2016, the church body makes a firm decision to be radical for the kingdom of God.
No.
To be radical in tearing down the strongholds that Satan puts on people. To be radical in seeing all kids come back to God. It's time to get radical. It's time to get radical. When I told Pastor Carlos in the priest's message, he said, you got to make sure people know you're not telling them to go kill nobody. I said, no. He said, you can get them riled up and they're going to run out of here, man. You're going to go get them. No, that's not it at all. It's not it at all. We're radical, tearing down Satan's strongholds. With that being said, I want to look at the man in the Bible who made that switch. Who made the switch from natural to supernatural. From ineffective to extremely effective. A man who went from natural to radical. Man's name is Peter. He was a fisherman who later became a disciple of Christ, one of the 12. But his name wasn't always Peter. His name was Simon. You see, when God first met him, his name was Simon. But all of that was going to change. So I entitled this message, From Simon to Peter. I'm going to set up this first thing. Andrew was Simon's brother. Andrew was a disciple of Christ. Before that, he was a disciple of John the Baptist. He heard John the Baptist say, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." He knew this was the Messiah. He knew this was the Christ. So he ran off and got his brother Simon. He said, "Simon, you got to come. We found the Messiah. We found the Christ." So Simon comes to meet Jesus. And that's where we take off. John 1:42. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. Isn't it amazing how Jesus already knows who we are? He didn't need no introduction. He told him who he was. "You are Simon. See, I know who you are, but I know who you will be." And that's what God sees in every one of us when we come to the cross. He knows who we are. He knows our conditions, but he knows who we will be. Now you ask, why did he change his name? What was wrong with the name Simon? In the Bible, there's so much in names. A name would determine what that person would be or what that person would do. Like Moses. He was a deliverer. That his name Moses meant deliver. So what did the name Simon mean? It meant hearer. It meant hearer. So you might ask, well, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with being a hearer? Why couldn't it just be that? Let's look at James 1:22 in the King James. It says, "But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." See, there's people who sit in church and they're hearers, and they deceive themselves into thinking they're part of God. They're just hearing. Never allowing God to actually come in and change their lives, change their hearts. See, Jesus is not looking to entertain you. He's looking to change you.
Yeah.
So many people go to a church because they got the good lights, or they got the nice band. They got all this stuff. They're looking to be entertained. We don't have the bells and whistles here, but the Holy Ghost is here.
Come on. Ooh.
You see, the reason people aren't seeing miracles in their lives because they're hearing and not never doing. How many people we see leave the church and they say, "That church thing just wasn't for me. Everybody else was getting it, but I wasn't getting it. It wasn't having an effect on me." The reason is because they were listening but never obeying. Are you obeying tonight? Are you obedient to Christ? You see, so many people want to blame God for that. And when I was writing this, I was thinking, that would be like if you went to the doctor and the doctor told you what your symptom was, gave you a prescription, you go home, you get the medicine, you look at the medicine, you read the directions, you open it up, you look at the pills, you smell it, you put the cap back on, you put it away, and you blame the doctor for not getting healed. You're not going to get healed by just knowing this medicine. You're not going to get healed by reading directions. You're going to get healed by taking what the doctor gave you. See, you're not going to get healed by hearing the word. You get healed when you take it in, when you do what he tells you to do. Look what Jesus said in John 8:31 about this. Jesus turned to the Jews who had claimed to believe in him. "If you stick with this, living out what I tell you, you are my disciples for sure. Then you will experience for yourselves the truth, and the truth will free you." How many times do you hear that spoken? You hear that? You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. But there's a key to that. See, the first part is the key. If you stick with this, living out what I tell you, then you will know the truth, and then the truth will set you free. See, just knowing about the truth will not set you free. It's when you hear the truth, you take the truth, and you do what the truth tells you to do. That's when you experience freedom. So let's look at Simon in Luke 5:47 and see if he was a hearer or if he was a doer now. It says, "When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, 'Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch.' Simon answered, 'Master, we worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets.' When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in other boats to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink." Jesus was a carpenter. Peter was a fisherman. Can you imagine this? They've been fishing all night. They come in to shallow land. They clean their nets. Jesus walks out. He gets in the boat. And he's going to start preaching to the people on the land, on the shore. When he's done preaching to them, when he's done speaking, he says, you know what? I've said enough to the hearers. I want to turn to a doer. I want to turn to somebody who's going to actually do what I told him to do. Hey, Peter, let's go out. Let's go back out. Peter could have said, look, you're a carpenter. I've been doing this my whole life. If I need advice on building a house, I'll ask you. This is my thing. I know what I'm doing. I've been doing this. I'm a young kid. There's no fish out there. We tried every trick in the book. There are no fish out there. I appreciate it, but I got it. He didn't say that. See, he didn't say that. He said, because you say so, I will let down the nets. Because you say so. That should be our response. There's going to be times where God's going to tell you to do stuff. There's going to be times where God might tell you to go speak to somebody, and it just might not seem right, and it might not make sense in the natural. But it's a wonderful opportunity to prove your obedience to God. It's a wonderful opportunity. Just trust God. I tell you, you want to be radical in life? Just do what Jesus says.
That's right.
You want to be radical? Do what he says. Well, what does he say? He says, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. You see somebody sick at work, go lay hands on them. See if the world don't think you're radical and probably a little crazy. But radical. He says, lay hands on the dead and they'll rise. Do that. You see a dead man, go pray over him and see if the world don't think you're radical. Just do what he says. You'll be the most radical person in the world. So let's continue the story in verse 8. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man. For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people. So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. That's right. Left everything to follow Jesus. See, Simon's second step in becoming radical was surrender. He was willing to surrender all, like the song we sang. He was willing to surrender everything to Jesus because he heard a call. Because he heard the call of God in his life, and he knew that nothing else mattered. Have you surrendered your life to God? You might say, yeah, but I want to read this definition of what surrender is. Webster's definition says, to yield to the power, control, or possession of another upon compulsion or demand. To give up completely or agree to forego, especially in favor of another. To give up completely. No more fighting. No more fighting. It's like, you know, if somebody's drowning, I heard this. If somebody's drowning, you have to wait for that person to completely give up, to completely just go under, to go rescue him. That's what God's looking for. He's looking for people just to completely give up, to completely just surrender. Say, God, I give up. I'm not fighting you anymore. The world's fighting God right now. They're going to turn, listen to me, the world's going to turn to everything it can besides God. I've seen it so many times. They will turn to drugs, alcohol, psychiatrists, doctors, palm readers. I've seen it all. Besides God, they won't turn to him. They refuse to surrender to God. But there's healing in surrender. Amen.
Amen.
When I was writing this, I was thinking about when Peter got home to his wife, because Peter was married. So when Peter got home, I was thinking about this is probably how it went. He probably walked in and probably told his wife, bet. Remember that guy I met a couple days ago? Remember I told you he changed my name? Remember I told you to stop calling me Simon? My name is Peter now. That guy. Well, you're not going to believe what happened. We were out all night. And we didn't catch anything. I'm telling you, even James and John, we caught nothing. So we were inland, and he got in my boat. He started preaching, and people were hearing, but they weren't really responding. They were just hearing what he was saying. And then he turned to me, and he told me, just go out, put my nets down. And he changed my name. He knew who I was, so I'm just going to be obedient, I guess. And I put my nets down, and he filled my nets. It was amazing. The boat started to sink. I could see him just looking at him. All right, Peter. I could hear him saying, and then we left everything. What? You left everything. Where's the boat, Peter? Go get your boat. It's on shore. I don't know what happened to it. It's gone. You should have saw that fish. There were so many fish. Where's the fish at, Peter? I left that too. Go get your boat, Peter. Go get back in that boat. You want to listen to that man, you can listen to him. But you're not giving up anything to follow him. I can see Peter saying, I have to. I heard God's voice. I heard God's voice. I'm telling you, I don't know how I'm going to provide. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't even know where I'm going. I didn't ask. But I know I'm following God. I'm not worried about the boat. I'm not worried about the fish. He told me I'm going to fish for men. That's what I'm going to do with my life. Now, I'm not saying that everybody in here when has to give up their business or give up exactly the same thing. Everybody's got a different calling on their life. But what I am saying is, what if God did ask you to give up the most important thing in your life? Would you do it? What if God did tell you to quit your job and you have all the security on? What if he told you to pack everything up and take your family to another country to preach the gospel to them? Would you do it? Do you love them that much? Pastor Call did.
Yeah.
I got so much respect for that man.
Uh-huh.
Pastor Call, when he got saved, he was in church, and he enjoyed being in church, and God started blessing his business. God started blessing, he'll tell you. He tells me all the time, Joe, I was making so much money, and I was making more than I could spend, and I was spending it. God was blessing him. See, God was filling his pockets, his bank account. God was blessing him. Just like God had filled up Peter's boat, he was blessing him. But when God called him, he left everything. Left everything. And I know when he says it, it's kind of like, yeah, but you got to put yourself in that spot. He left everything. He didn't even know if he was going to get paid. He'll tell you, I didn't even know how much I was going to make. He didn't even know how he was going to provide. But he knew he heard a call. He knew he heard God's voice.
Mm-hmm.
He knew he couldn't deny it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he knew the reason why he was blessed is because God. He knew it was God blessing him. You see, Peter knew the reason he was fishing that boat was because God was there.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he was willing to lay his life down because he knew the only reason he had life was because it was God who gave it to him. There's people out there who say, I don't want to waste my breath on Jesus. If they only knew the only reason they had breath was because of Jesus.
Come on.
Glory to God.
Glory.
I want you to think about this. What if Pastor Carl would have rejected that? What if he just said, I'm satisfied, I'm comfortable? A lot of times we get set in this comfortable ways of ours. We like to be comfortable. We don't like to be uncomfortable. What if he just said that? Somebody else would have got that call. Somebody else would be pastor of this church. And he would have probably retired a hairstylist. I want you to think about Peter. What if Peter would have rejected the call? Would have said, I'm just going to stick to what I know. Peter probably would have died a fisherman. Pastor Carl has seen miracle after miracle after miracle. Life change after life change. Salvation after salvation. You think he would have saw any of that had he rejected God? Would he have saw any kind of miracles in his life had he rejected God's call? What about Peter? Peter walked and ate with God. Peter wrote 1 and 2 Peter in our Bibles. Preached the first ever Holy Spirit-filled message. Helped build the first church. You think any of that would happen if he had stayed a fisherman? You want to be radical, it's going to take surrender. Because it's not going to be anything to do with you. It's going to be all of God.
Amen.
And we see people in the Bible walk away from Jesus and reject that call. The rich young ruler, when he came to Jesus, Jesus said, you want to follow me? Go sell all you have. He couldn't do that. And guess what? You never see his name mentioned again in that Bible. There's other times where people come to Jesus. Jesus says, follow me. Oh, we will. But first, I have something to do. You never hear that man's name again. Another man. I'll follow you, but first, let me go do this. See, I like you, Jesus. But you're like fourth in my life. You're not first. So let me go handle this first, and then I'll come catch up with you guys. No, that's okay. See, God's not going to play second fiddle to nobody. You never hear their names again. And I'm telling you, I'm obedient to God. And I've surrendered to God. And my name may not be written in this book. But there is a book with my name in it.
Come on. Yes.
That's the Lamb's Book of Life. You see, when I get to heaven and I see God, he's going to open up that book. And he's going to look. And he's going to see my name. And he's going to say, come on in, son. I'm going in. Praise God, I'm not going to be rejected. Praise God. Oh, man. There's people in our lives who never experienced the supernatural. Never experienced miracles in their lives. Because they refused to surrender. When I'm sitting with people in the world, it's like, man, I just wish you could just see the things I'm seeing. I wish you could just experience the things I'm experiencing. I wish you could just see the miracles that are taking place and the lives that are changing. But they don't. They don't experience that because they refuse to surrender. You know, I get to be with both sides. I get to be with the people who are sold out for God. I get to be with the true Christians. And then I get to be with people in the world. And I get to hear both sides of how they live life. And the worldly people, they're talking about the same old stuff. The same 9-to-5 job. The same old stories, the same old gossip. And then you go and you sit down. My favorite thing to do is sit down with some elders. Soon as I get there with some elders in the church, you don't hear a peep out of me. I'm quiet as can be. I just want to hear what they have to say. I want to hear the stories of things that they've seen in their life. I love it. I was sitting down with Pastor Manuel and Pastor Carl, and they were talking about some stories. Pastor Manuel was like, Pastor Carl, remember back in 1985? Remember back in 1985 when we went to visit that little island, Guatemala, that little church? Remember that little church? The place was packed. There was none of that stuff. The place was just packed full of people. They just wanted to hear the message. Remember you preached the Spirit-filled message? Remember the fire fell in that place? Remember the Holy Spirit came down and everybody started speaking in tongues? And everybody just went out? Remember that? Well, how about that time that girl showed up with that leg showed on the other? And we laid hands on her. And her leg grew back in my hand. Pastor Carl, remember that? Wow, that was amazing. Now weigh them out. I'm saying, okay, on this side, I could have the supernatural and the miraculous things take place in my life. Or I could just go back to the natural, the normal things, the things that everybody else is experiencing. Now, why would anybody want the natural? I'm going to tell you why. Because the natural don't require you to give up anything. See, you could have the natural. You could have all the lust, all the flesh desires you want. And you don't have to give up nothing except your own soul. That's what the devil won't tell you. Is all of that stuff is going to come with a price at the end. You're building up a large price tag. But see, the supernatural, on the other hand, it's going to cost you everything. You're going to have to give up everything that you love in this world. All the fleshly desires that you love in order for God to pour out his miraculous in your life. I'll go with the miraculous. I'll go with God.
Amen.
You know, there's people who won't give up anything for God. Christians won't give up anything. Do you know if a Muslim decides to follow Christ, that he can be disowned by his own family? If a Muslim decides he is going to lay down everything and follow Christ, he loses his mom, he loses his dad, his brother and sister, and that's if he's lucky. Most times they kill him. Can you imagine that, making that decision to follow Christ? Being killed by your own family. What would make a man do that? What would make a man give up everything to follow God? See, it's because this man had a real revelation of who Jesus really was. See, it's not about church, people. It's not about church to them. They had a real revelation of who Jesus really is. And once you've seen that, you're willing to lay it all down.
Amen.
If it's church, you're not going to give up anything. You're going to come in and leave the same way. But I'm telling you, if you had a real revelation of who Jesus Christ really is, you will lay it all down.
Amen.
There's nothing you wouldn't give up.
That's right.
If we're going to be radical for God, we're going to need that revelation. If you're going to be willing to give up, if you're going to be willing to step out, you're going to need a revelation. It's not going to be about church and how good church songs were, and how great the light show was. It's going to be about a revelation. You're going to have to really know him. Peter received that revelation. Let's look at Matthew 16, verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. But this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and that on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." People back then had their opinions about Jesus just like they do today. You go ask 10 people out in the world who they think Jesus is, you're going to hear 10 different responses. He was a good man. He was a prophet. Oh, he was a radical. He wasn't real. All of this stuff. But God don't care. See, God don't care what the world says about him. You notice his response? What about you? What do you say? Who do you say I am?
Come on.
That's good.
You ever notice when you're talking with somebody about Jesus, you both got the same name, right? But you feel like you're talking about two different people?
Mm-hmm.
You're like, yeah, that's his name, but he never said that. Oh, yeah, that's his name, but no, he didn't do that. No. You got the wrong guy there. You see, that's because flesh and blood revealed Jesus to them. But a real Christian gets that revelation from God the Father.
Come on.
Right.
You're going to need a real revelation. You see, I was in church from the time I was 16 to the time I was 21. Hearing a pastor speak about Jesus over and over again. I was relying on a man's revelation of who Jesus was, and it never changed my life. Never changed me, and it won't change anybody. It was until one day, while I was worshiping, God himself revealed himself to me. God revealed himself on a cross to me, bleeding for me. He revealed that he died for me because he couldn't live without me. He showed me that he was bleeding up there because he loved me. And he wanted me. I'm telling you, that's a revelation that changes people.
Amen.
That's a revelation. Once you get that kind of revelation, you'll leave everything.
Yes.
Now you see, Peter was obedient, he was surrendered, and now he had a revelation. But still there was something missing because he wasn't solid. You see, Jesus changed his name to Peter. Peter means rock. You see, Jesus is looking for something that's solid that he could build on. He's not looking for hearers, like I said. He's looking for rocks. He's looking for a foundation that he could build his church on. But there was something missing. He said, I didn't have time to go through it. But Peter, while Jesus was walking on the water, Jesus said, "Peter, come out." And he did. And then he sank. And Jesus said, "Why did you doubt me?" See, he doubted a little bit. And then there was another time where Jesus was telling him, "I have to go to the cross, I have to die." Peter said, "No, you're not going to do that," and he rebuked him. Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan." You see, Peter's walk wasn't that solid yet. On a night Jesus got arrested, he denied Jesus 3 times to a girl. 3 times. Denied Jesus. Said he wouldn't, but he did. But if you skip ahead to the book of Acts, Acts 2, Peter was bold. Peter preached to a large Jewish crowd, the same Jewish crowd that was demanding the blood of Jesus, that was demanding crucify him. Now he's preaching to them. He denied Jesus to a girl, and now he's preaching to a crowd of Jews. Something happened. Something changed in Peter's walk. You see, Peter had to find a missing ingredient, that missing key that we all need if we're going to be bold and radical for God. You go to Acts 3. Peter and John are walking. There's a lame beggar laying on the ground saying, "Give me some money, some change." Peter said, silver and gold I have none, but what I have I give you. Stand up and walk in the name of Jesus. What happened to Peter? All of a sudden he's bold now. All of a sudden he's performing miracles in the name of Jesus. And then they bring him to the Jewish council. It would be like one of us being brought to the government. And they're telling him, stop speaking that name. Stop speaking that name. And Peter said, I please to see God. No, sorry. I desire to please God, not man. I won't stop speaking. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine standing up before the government and saying, I'm not going to stop speaking that name. I'm not going to stop. What was that missing ingredient, Peter? Acts 5, verse 15. As a result, people brought the sick. This is another miracle. As a result, people brought the sick into the street, laid them on beds and mats, so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits. All of them were healed. If his own shadow would fall on somebody, it would get healed. That's radical. Can you imagine that? If your shadow fell on somebody, they got healed. That's radical. So what was that missing key? Acts 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, like we are here. And suddenly a sound came from heaven like a rushing violent wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. There appeared to them tongues resembling fire, which were being distributed among them. And they rested on each one of them as each person received the Holy Spirit. And they were all filled, that is, diffused throughout their being with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other tongues, different languages, as the Spirit was given the ability to speak out clearly and appropriately. The missing key was the Holy Ghost. The missing key was the fire of God. See, if you're going to be radical, you're going to need a fire. The fire of God to burn inside of you. You're going to need God to set a spark in you. It's going to cause you to move. It's going to cause you to burn for Him. It's going to cause you to do the things that He wants you to do. That's the Holy Ghost. See, Peter probably did not want to deny Jesus, but on his own strength and ability, he couldn't do it. He couldn't stand up. He was too scared. And God knew that. But see, God lets people fall to let them realize that it's not going to be by your strength. It's not going to be by your might, but by my Spirit, declares the Lord. You're going to need His Spirit. If you're ever going to stand to this world, if you're ever going to be bold in your speaking, you're going to need His Spirit. It's going to have nothing to do with you. You see, Muslims radicalize people by brainwashing and by filling them with hate. But God radicalizes us by washing us with His blood and filling us with His Holy Ghost. That's how you become radicalized. Now, if you're here today and you say, I'm ready to be obedient to God, you're ready to surrender your life to Him, and today's the perfect day to make this New Year's resolution. Remember I said the resolution means to make a firm decision to or not to do something. You see, today, you have to make a decision. You're either going to follow God or you're not. And tomorrow's not promised. You have to make a firm decision today. I'm either following Him or I'm not. There is no in-between. There is no fence riders here. There's no lukewarm in God's kingdom. God's looking for a firm decision. Are you going to follow me or not? Stand with me. You're ready to be obedient to God. You're ready to surrender your life to God because you hear a call. Because you hear the same call Peter heard. You're ready to lay it all down, no matter what it is. You're ready to lay it down because you know it's more important. If that's you, I believe God will meet you in this place. I believe God will give you that revelation of Himself. And I believe God will fill you with His Holy Spirit. God desires that. God wants to meet you. God wants to fill you with His Holy Spirit. God wants you to be with Him. He died for it. He loves you. With every head bowed and every eye closed. If that's you, if you want to make that firm decision today to follow God, I want you to put your hand up. I want to pray with you. I see that hand. Praise God. I'll see that hand. Put your hand down. You know, every time you see a salvation, you're seeing a miracle take place. You see, religion can dress up the outside, but only God can change the heart. God wants to change hearts. Everybody else who's saved, praise God. I want y'all to come up here. We're going to pray with y'all. We're going to pray that God stirs up a fire inside of y'all. Some people already have the fire. We're going to pray that God reignites that fire. See, the Holy Ghost is considered like the wind. I'm going to pray that the wind comes in and blows on that fire and causes it to kick up. We all need to be reignited. Y'all can come forward.
place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you,
Thank you.